Good afternoon. Hello and welcome. My name is Chris Woolforth. I'm the director of the Montgomery Fellows Program, one of your hosts for this afternoon. It's my very distinct pleasure to welcome you to this presentation by U.S. Ambassador to Sweden, Mark Brzezinski. Since 1977, the Montgomery Fellows Program has brought to campus distinguished individuals from all fields of human endeavor to enrich the Dartmouth education. This winter, we are focusing on the role of different communities in assessing and addressing global climate change. We have partnered with the Institute of Arctic Studies, housed in the Dickey Center for International Understanding, in celebration of the creation of a new Fulbright Polar Initiative, which aims to identify and support interdisciplinary research policymakers need in order to assess global climate change impacts. Dartmouth has a special role to play in this initiative, as our own Ross Virginia, Professor of Environmental Science and Director of the Institute of Arctic Studies, has been appointed to co-direct it. Assessing and addressing the impacts of global climate change requires the cooperation of many different human communities. There are the individuals and societies whose lives and livelihoods are profoundly affected by climate change. There are the scientific communities who seek to understand the causes, consequences, and future impacts of these changes. And then there are the global policy communities who strive to coordinate the collective action necessary to both mitigate and respond to these changes. Each of these communities has a vital role to play, and none can work in isolation from the other. This afternoon, we have the great good fortune to bring representatives of two of these key constituencies in global climate change together to tease out some of the challenges in effectively responding to this global phenomena. To lay the foundation of our understanding of the geopolitical challenges and diplomatic opportunities in responding to the impacts of global climate change, we are delighted to welcome back to Dartmouth a very distinguished member of the class of 1987, Mark Brzezinski. Since his appointment as U.S. Ambassador to the Kingdom of Sweden in 2011, Ambassador Brzezinski has made the understanding of the global impact of climate change and environmental challenges in the Arctic and the development of strong international cooperation in the region a key focus of his work. Part of this focus has been the development of a series of videos and a Twitter feed on the challenge of climate change and international cooperation in the Arctic. These are designed to make these challenges relatable to a general audience and part of our public discourse. We will learn more about this in today's presentation. Ambassador Brzezinski has both a broad and deep training in the complexity of international cooperation. He is, after all, a Dartmouth graduate, having majored in government. He supplemented his Dartmouth education with a JD from the University of Virginia and a DPhil in political science from the University of Oxford. He undertook research on constitutional design while a Fulbright scholar in Poland, resulting in his book, The Struggle for Constitutionalism in Poland. He is also the author of numerous articles on foreign policy and law. His scholarly career has been amply supplemented by rich experiences in both the private and public sectors. As an attorney, his early work for the firm Hogan & Hartson focused on assisting U.S. companies in their expansion around the world and creation of opportunities in developing countries. More recently, he served as a partner in the Washington, D.C. office of McGuire Woods, specializing in anti-corruption law. In between, he invested significant time in public service. From 1999 to 2001, he served as a director on the National Security Council in the Clinton White House, where he coordinated interagency policy formulation and advised the President and National Security Advisor on issues relating to Russia, Eurasia, and the Balkans. This had him deeply involved in issues such as democracy promotion, international public law, and war crimes accountability. He helped lead U.S. policy implementation in relation to NATO expansion and in response to the Kosovo conflict, and coordinated presidential summits in Russia and Ukraine. It is worth emphasizing that this experience in the seemingly intractable issues relating to Russia makes him amply qualified to assist in the equally seemingly intractable issues of global climate change, and perhaps, given the recent events in Ukraine, relieved to no longer be on the Russia desk. As ambassador, Brzezinski has done some truly historic things. He presided over the first visit of a sitting president to the Kingdom of Sweden since our two countries began diplomatic relations. He also presided over the visits of two secretaries of state, including the visit of Senator Kerry, whom he took into the Arctic in order to help publicize the challenges of global climate change and bring attention to that region. His ambassadorship has not been one about stewardship, but about developing a new modern diplomacy using new partners and new tools. Some of these he'll describe today, but he'll even go so far as to appear in reality television in Sweden in order to make a connection with Swedes. In a moment, Ambassador Brzezinski will share with us his adventures in modern diplomacy with regards to global climate change. Following his presentation, we will have the opportunity to have a representative of the scientific community addressing climate change engage this representative of the diplomatic community on this issue when Professor Ross Virginia joins the ambassador for a question and answer session. Ross Virginia is an equally distinguished representative for his role in that conversation. He is the Myers Family Professor of Environmental Science, Professor of Environmental Sciences, Adjunct Professor of Biological Sciences and Earth Sciences, Director of the Institute of Arctic Studies, and Director of its Integrated Graduate Education Research Trainingship Program in Polar Science, and most recently, co-distinguished lead scholar of the Fulbright Arctic Initiative, which makes me think that his business card must be the size of a refrigerator box. He is an ecosystem scientist interested in how rapid environmental change affects ecosystem and society. He specializes in how climate change alters vegetation and soil and the ecological benefits they provide. And he has conducted research in Antarctica for more than 20 field seasons, where he examines carbon and nitrogen cycling in the continent's polar deserts. In the last decade, he's expanded this work to the tundra of Western Greenland. Not many people living today can claim to have a place named after him, but Virginia Valley in Antarctica bears his name in honor of his many contributions to science there. He is an award-winning teacher and mentor to generations of students, perhaps his highest accomplishment. But equally and significantly, he is a scientist who recognizes that his work cannot be done in isolation of the political and social processes that shape responses to climate change. And he has dedicated the last decade of his career to creating opportunities for all the constituent communities in climate change to work and learn together. So there's much we're going to learn today. Let's get started. Please join me in warmly welcoming first Ambassador Mark Brzezinski.
Thank you, Chris. Thank you very much. Thank you. Good afternoon, everyone. I am so glad to be back at Dartmouth as U.S. Ambassador with my wife. It shows that dreams come true and that Dartmouth is an incredible platform to pursue your dreams. Thank you, Chris, so much for that introduction, and thank you to the Montgomery Fellowship for bringing Natalia and me to Dartmouth. We've had the most incredible set of engagements with Dartmouth students throughout the day. And thank you, Ross Virginia, for your leadership of the new Fulbright Arctic Initiative and for all the support and engagement that you have provided U.S. Embassy Sweden in the last couple of years. Ladies and gentlemen, today I'm here to talk with you about the Arctic, climate change, and diplomacy. This, my friends, is why the Arctic matters.
If this climate change keeps going at this rate, I'm pretty sure that the reindeer won't survive it. Yeah. It goes too fast right now. And without the reindeer, the whole Sami culture will disappear. Mm. And the world will be an indigenous people poorer.
Ladies and gentlemen, that's Nila Inga, a Sami leader in that part of Sweden that is above the Arctic Circle. And his message is a warning we should heed, because in 80 years, our society could be threatened. There's a direct link between what is happening in the Arctic and what happens in your own backyard. Unless we get global warming under control, human society is in trouble. Here is a map of the Arctic Circle and the eight countries that overlay it, the five Nordics, Canada, the United States, and Russia. It includes, of course, Sweden and our country, which is an Arctic country. 16% of American landmass is in Alaska, and of course, Alaska lays right on the Arctic Circle. And when you take a look at this map, you can see why no one country is preponderant in the Arctic, and it's a region that requires constructive international cooperation. Why do changes in the Arctic matter for the Earth as a whole? Because what happens in the Arctic doesn't stay in the Arctic. The Arctic is a refrigerator for the planet. When the Arctic warms more dramatically than anywhere else on Earth, it of course impacts life in the Arctic. It impacts subsistence societies. It impacts in terms of village erosion and relocation. And it impacts sensitive biodiversity. But it also impacts us. It makes a huge difference in terms of the weather of North America. It results in a higher occurrence of extreme weather events like storm surges and droughts. You read last week in the newspapers about the mega droughts, years-long droughts coming our way. It results in sea level rise. It results in release of dangerous methane. So there's a direct interaction between what happens in the Arctic and what happens in the rest of the world. Let's just look at one piece of this, the loss of sea ice and snow cover. You can see from this slide that Arctic sea ice and snow cover is a mere shadow of its former self. Arctic sea ice is half of what it was. 2014 was the hottest year on record. 13 of the warmest years on record have occurred since the year 2000. We are potentially looking at an ice-free summer in the Arctic as early as 2040, which is just 25 years from now. And the loss of sea ice is both an indicator and an amplifier of climate change because sea ice reflects solar energy to space. In fact, 80 to 90% of solar energy is reflected back to space by ice. Dark ocean water absorbs 85% of solar energy. So replacing ice, as we can see, with open water is like replacing a mirror with a sponge, as one scientist put it. Why does all this matter to us in this room right now? Scientists are predicting and projecting catastrophic consequences for mankind and the planet if we stay on the current global warming path. That path is likely to trigger irreversible melting of the Greenland ice sheet, which is the second largest next to the Antarctic ice sheet. Its melting could lead to a 23-foot sea level rise. 50% of the US coastline is in the zone of sea level rise impacts, which means that millions of Americans will be affected. And it's not just us in the United States. Other low-lying countries around the world may be even more severely affected. Take, for example, Bangladesh. Bangladesh alone has roughly 17 million people who live less than 1 meter above the sea level. So the bottom line is that a really negative human and geopolitical reality could emerge that affects the globe. Large-scale ecosystems could collapse, human migration could increase to untenable levels, and this could impact the global economy. On the flip side, any legitimate action inhibiting climate change will require unprecedented levels of international cooperation and self-sacrifice. So that's the essence of the challenge that we all face. I come to this as someone passionate about the environment from a very young age. I was raised in a family where being outdoors was a central part of growing up. In the photo in the center, I'm in Maine with my brother and sister. Maine is experiencing increasing temperatures, shorter winters, hotter summers arriving much earlier and lasting longer. I love to go picking mussels with my mom on Little Cranberry Island in Maine, but there's an increase in red tides due to warming, which makes mussling something I can't do with my five-year-old daughter. Moose populations in Maine, which made a real bounce back in the last couple of decades, are impacted because warmer winters enable ticks to survive. Ticks carry disease. Ticks carry disease, and not just for moose, but for people as well, and moose become infested. I grew up in Virginia, which is the top left picture. I loved to go to the Chesapeake Bay as a kid. Climate change, though, today is increasing harmful blooms of algae in coastal waters, and there is an increase in Category 4 and 5 hurricanes across the South. When I arrived in 1983 at Dartmouth, and you can see in the top right-hand photo, I'm in front of Top Lift Dorm with my mom. Dartmouth was practically known as a subarctic school. It was so cold, and that's something that's reinforced when you walk outside right now. But today, New Hampshire is experiencing later autumns and earlier springs. There's less snow, more rain, and it's already impacting life as we know it around here in little and big ways. There's less of a ski season. It impacts apple and maple syrup crops. Sugar maples decline as the climate warms. So there's many different ways that our lives are impacted. As I said earlier, America's Arctic area is in Alaska, and in the mid-1990s, I traveled across Alaska with my brother through Glacier Bay National Park, which is where we are in this photo. Glaciers provide some of the most visible manifestations of massive climate change. Will Glacier Bay National Park in Alaska have no glaciers in the future? Well, maybe. There is widespread glacier retreat in Alaska. Here's Muir Glacier in Glacier Bay National Park. In Alaska. Look at the change from 1941. That's incredible change in little more than a half century, and not just in Alaska. Here's Rabots Glacier in Sweden's high north, in Sweden's Arctic area. And this is change manifest since 1910. The top photo is 1910. The bottom photo is just a couple of years ago. I took a helicopter with Sweden's leading comedian, Felix Herngren, also not a scientist, but both of us desiring to bear witness to the immense change to Sweden's Arctic area. I took a helicopter to this particular glacier, and it's part of the video series that Felix Herngren, Sweden's leading comedian, and I pulled together at hashtag our shared Arctic. Please visit our video series. We'd love to hear what you think about it. So that's the passion that I brought to U.S. Embassy Stockholm when I went to Sweden as U.S. ambassador in 2011. And I want to share with you how I've tackled the threat of climate change and how I've tried to use my platform as an ambassador to work on this problem. And I've worked my tail off to try to highlight this challenge and to symbolize an underlying closeness between America and Sweden on climate change on the Arctic. For example, I've worked to increase the number of top-level visitors to Sweden as their presence is critical in brokering agreements and raising awareness. On the far right-hand photo is a picture that was taken just last month when the United States' new special representative for the Arctic, Admiral Robert Papp, visited Sweden. Special representative for the Arctic is a brand new position in the U.S. government. It is a historic position, and it shows the focus with which President Obama and Secretary Kerry are pursuing the Arctic challenge. And he visited Sweden to meet with scientists and government counterparts, but also to listen and learn from the Swedes. But I think perhaps the most poignant moment of his visit to Sweden just last month in the middle of January was when the World Wildlife Fund took both of us out on a boat in the middle of the Swedish archipelago, just outside of Stockholm. In the middle of January, I repeat, and it was completely open water. The captain of our boat had lived in the archipelago on one of the islands for 25 years. He remembered trucks being driven out on the winter ice to deliver supplies. Only a few years ago, that boat ride, just 10 years ago, that boat ride might not have been possible because of ice cover in the Swedish archipelago. Now, as you can see, it's completely open water. And it was completely open water just a couple days when I left Sweden to come to Dartmouth. In the far left photo is a visit in 2012 that Secretary of State, then Secretary of State, Hillary Clinton made to Sweden. And she came to Sweden to advance a global effort focused on reducing black carbon and methane. And she and the United States and Sweden formed a coalition called the Carbon and Clean Air Coalition, the CCAC, of a disparate, different set of countries around the world, Bangladesh, Mexico, Ghana, all focused on highlighting how by using existing technologies, we can avoid 30% of our global warming today. In the center photo, you can see Secretary of State John Kerry in his visit to Sweden's Arctic area in Kiruna, Sweden, where our friend Nila Inga lives, Sami leader, Nila Inga lives, for the Arctic Council Ministerial. What an opportunity for the Secretary of State to come to Sweden for the Arctic Council Ministerial. Because wherever the Secretary of State goes, 100 journalists and 100 photographers go as well. So for a day, the focus was on the Arctic and the challenges that we face together on climate change, and it provides great visibility. But also at that Arctic Council Ministerial, some historic agreements were formed between the Arctic Council 8 countries, which of course are the 5 Nordic countries, Russia, Canada, and the United States. An agreement was formed around search and rescue. An agreement was formed on oil spill preparedness and response, critical needs as resource development advances in the Arctic. The question of observership of Arctic Council proceedings was clarified by Secretary Kerry and the other 7 foreign leaders at the Kiruna Ministerial. A number of countries that are not part of the Arctic Council have submitted applications to observe Arctic Council proceedings, like China, India, Korea, Singapore, and others. And that observership question was handled during that Arctic Council Ministerial, and they were brought in as new observers, which is of incredible utility for the Arctic Council, but also for those new observer states. In the fall of 2013, I was so pleased to welcome President Obama to Sweden. As Chris said, the first ever visit by a sitting US president to Sweden's capital of Stockholm. A number of different things were done during President Obama's visit, but importantly, you see on the right here a photo of the 5 Nordic leaders who flew into Sweden, the Finnish president and then the prime ministers of Iceland, Norway, Denmark. And they joined the Swedes and the United States in agreeing to end public financing of new coal-fired power plants overseas, except in rare circumstances. And those 5 leaders, plus the president, agreed to work together to secure support for other countries and multilateral development banks to adopt similar policies. That was a real breakthrough in terms of energy development. But I also took President Obama outside of government buildings to bear witness on sustainability innovation. Sustainability innovation is something that America shares with Sweden. And here is the president at Sweden's MIT, or perhaps I should say more appropriately, at Sweden's Dartmouth, called the Royal Institute of Technology, KTH, where the president bore witness to different forms of sustainability innovation. He saw a cell phone charger powered by pouring water on a small disposable metal disc. He saw a portable water treatment unit that uses the sun to make water drinkable. He bore witness to a Swedish biogas bus engine, and as the president emphasized, the private sector innovation and financing are key to getting innovation in sustainability right. So I have actively sought to bring and to engage top US government officials in Sweden on climate change. But I have to tell you, folks, that it is hard to communicate the issue of climate change. It's slow moving, it's global, it's complex, it goes to the heart of our economy. So as Chris noted, I've tried to use new tools like social media, like the YouTube platform, and new partnerships outside of government with businesses, with actors and people in film to combine the platform that I have with their platform. Here's an example. Mm-hmm. But what was extraordinary about today was not just what we witnessed now, but comparing that to the picture of 50 years ago, 100 years ago, and seeing just the scale of change.
Yeah, I think, I mean, our grandparents, they could have seen this, even if they weren't, but our grandchildren could maybe, instead of see that, see an ocean which is 7 meters higher than right. this, and a devastated world, kind of.
That's right. And I think that what we heard today also is not only evidence of this change, but also that there are some possibilities to do something about it. And that begs the question for us, for our generation, and also future generations. Mm. What is important to us?
Yeah.
That's an important question for today and tomorrow.
Yeah, and for the viewers here. Yeah.
New tools and new partnerships, critical opportunities in modern diplomacy that can advance our collective self-interest on climate change and other national security threats. Another area that I've really zeroed in on as ambassador is in the area of scientific exchanges, because the more we all understand what is happening, the better off we all are. It's also about building networks between people across borders and learning from each other regarding what works and what it is that we can do together. Exchanges are one of the most incredibly effective foreign policy tools that we have today. In 2013, I hosted in northern Sweden at the Abisko Scientific Research Center, Fulbright scholars from around the Arctic countries to discuss different pieces of scientific work that they are doing, and that became the genesis of a new Fulbright focus on the Arctic.
I'm so pleased to announce that the United States State Department will have its flagship overseas scholarship program focus on one of the most important strategic questions in the next couple of years, and that is the Arctic and what's happening in the Arctic. How is the Arctic changing? Andrea, why is the Arctic important for all of us?
Our flagship U.S. fellowship and research program now focus on the Arctic, co-lead scholar Professor Ross Virginia is helping run it. I can't wait to see what the Arctic Fulbright produces and what you advance, Ross. The U.S. Embassy in Stockholm has also created a separate set of scholarships supported by Coca-Cola, Google, LKAB, and others. It's called the REACT Scholarship, and REACT stands for Research on Environmental Action and Clean Tech. And what we've done with REACT is we have brought young Swedes to America, and we've brought young Americans like you to Sweden to study sustainability. So we've sent Swedish students to Tallahassee, Florida, to study recycling, to Lawrence, New Jersey, to study eco-farms, to Portland, Oregon, to take a look at local approaches. And we've brought American students to Sweden. So the photo on the lower right here is of three American women who were REACT scholars in Sundsvall, Sweden, and we're standing there with the mayor of Sundsvall. Dartmouth has information on both the new Fulbright Arctic program and on REACT. I can tell you that in Sweden, we want you, come visit us, go after one of those scholarships. The U.S. Embassy has also created a group called the Swedish-American Green Alliance, or SAGA. The goal is to bring around one table all the stakeholders. How can scientists and industry and business and policymakers work together? SAGA seeks to develop new partnerships and to share success stories in an incredibly important opportunity in Sweden. Why? Because there's one fact or one arithmetical number that I think was one of the most attractive things to President Obama in terms of bringing him to Sweden. And that is, Sweden is one of the few countries in the world that in the last 20 years has grown its economy by 40% while at the same time reducing carbon output by 20%. I repeat, they've grown their economy while reducing carbon output. That's what we seek to do. The Obama administration is on track to do it. But that's the important opportunity of this moment. And SAGA has tried to highlight ways people can actually make money through sustainability. Here I am in Stockholm's wastewater treatment center in Lidingö, which is one of the districts of Stockholm, with the mayor of Lidingö. And the Lidingö wastewater treatment center makes $5 million a year selling biogas that they collect from waste. That's the opportunity that will make sustainability real, that it creates jobs and it creates prosperity, and it does. Take a look at what's happening in Sweden. I've also worked together to bring different NGOs and different educational groups to build partners. in Sweden. You know Rainforest Alliance with the little green frog on the can of soda? Well, we brought the Rainforest Alliance in this photo on the left and their CEO to Sweden to see what connections we can help germinate between rainforest in New York City and Swedish businesses and Swedish policymakers and government officials. We partnered with National Geographic on top, and their CEO, Gary Knell, and a number of board members, their chief scientists and others, came to Sweden to talk about sustainable development in the Arctic. And in November, I co-hosted with Dartmouth a major large event for focusing on Dartmouth alumni. And we hosted a panel discussion on public communication on Arctic issues. We had real experts like Professor Ross Virginia, Professor Wagner, consider how to engage the public on Arctic issues. What works? We had 100 Dartmouth alumni come in from around Europe, from Germany, from England, and they met with members of Sweden's academic and policy communities. The power to convene is one of the important opportunities that you have as an ambassador and an embassy overseas, and we've done whatever we can to use that to advance the efforts against climate change and on the future of the Arctic. So why is the Arctic important? I've done these things because I want to increase understanding of why the Arctic is important. Part of the problem is that too few people know about it. Vast numbers of people are unaware of the imminence of this threat. And time is not on our side. The generation after the next generation will really feel it. So why is the Arctic important? Because the Arctic is the way we're going to be able to deal with the problem of climate change or fail. As I said earlier, what happens in the Arctic doesn't stay in the Arctic. So how do we, as a nation, engage on the Arctic? There's different ways to see the Arctic, and where you stand is where you is where you sit, as they say. The starting point, people of the Arctic. The Arctic is the home for millions of people. 4 million people, 50,000 Americans live above the Arctic Circle, whose societies themselves within the Arctic are themselves very differentiated. The European or Nordic Arctic is very developed in comparison to the North American Arctic, where we have communities that are much more spread out and remote. And as a consequence, there's less access to infrastructure and services. We need to change that. There's the maritime perspective, and shipping companies will tell you that with the melting of the ice and creating ice-free sea passages, you can cut off 2 weeks of shipping time from Asia to Europe. They see what's happening in the Arctic as akin to the simultaneous building of the Suez Canal and the Panama Canal. Of course, nothing is being built, but with the opening of those sea passages, it's the essential same opportunity that such canals would provide. Others see the Arctic as a rich source of natural resources. It's estimated to hold 13% of the world's undiscovered oil and 30% of the natural gas reserves. So the Arctic is simultaneously a strategic problem and a human problem. Let's discuss the strategic dimensions. An important starting point is that all Arctic states, and quite frankly, all states, benefit from a peaceful and cooperative agreement on the Arctic and the geopolitical stability that that creates. So we need to be vigilant to the emergence of circumstances in which that peaceful approach could change, like some kind of race to control energy resources. But even in that context, even good friends can have disputes. For example, the US has a maritime dispute with Canada, or a maritime issue with Canada. Both countries have yet to agree to a maritime boundary that would divide our overlapping extended continental shelf. The disagreement is not an impediment to our bilateral relationship. We're working together to collect data and to reach an agreement. But it's an example of why the US needs to accede to the Law of the Sea Convention. The US is the only Arctic country not to accede to the Law of the Sea Convention. It would provide a legal framework to advance a range of US interests. The last four administrations, Republican and Democrat, have supported ratification. Congress needs to act. Let me just say something about Russia. Following Russia's actions in Ukraine, the US has not returned to business as usual with Russia. Russia's aggression in Ukraine has strained relations between Arctic states, and it has complicated some of the work on Arctic issues. But the U.S. has worked with Russia on Arctic issues during past crises, and we're going to continue to work with Russia under the auspices of the Arctic Council. But a particular point I want to emphasize is the importance of avoiding militarization of the Arctic. Militarization of the Arctic would be counterproductive to any comprehensive international cooperation. Let me say something about the human dimension. Again, millions of people live above the Arctic Circle. Many struggle for basic necessities of food, water, and shelter, and many depend on a healthy ecosystem. Climate change is threatening the Arctic's rich biodiversity, including vital fish stocks. We have an obligation for them to thrive. But another piece of the human dimension and the Arctic is us. If one wants to witness one's self-interest when it comes to the Arctic, just look at your grandchildren. If there is massive global warming, how will society react? Who determines haves and have-nots in that context? To address at least some of these strategic and human questions is why the Arctic Council was created. Eight nations created the Arctic Council in 1996. It's proven an effective and cooperative forum in which Arctic states and other concerned organizations develop effective ways for managing this precious resource. So 2016, the Arctic Council will be 20 years old, and that will provide the US an opportunity to do a mid-chairmanship review of what we are doing. The US will assume the chairmanship of the Arctic Council this spring. One way the United States is preparing for its chairmanship is by looking to previous chairmanships and what worked. In the case of Sweden, Sweden's chairmanship was between 2011 and 2013. I was in Sweden during its chairmanship. And one of the things I really noticed about Sweden's approach to its chairmanship pertains to the Swedish word lagom, which means balance. The Swedes took a balanced approach between advancing economic cooperation, protecting biodiversity, and protecting the societies of the native peoples that live in the Arctic area. That, combined with skillful diplomacy, solid internal and external communications, real resources, and active listening, produced real deliverables, and I referred to them earlier, including the search and rescue agreement, including oil spill preparedness and prevention, and expanding the number of observers. Sweden's record on climate change, I think, provided a very good context for that, in the sense that you have a whole of society commitment to addressing the issue of climate change, with the goal for the country to becoming completely fossil fuel free by 2050. Everything that I've talked about up to now in my presentation leads to the incredible opportunity of the US Arctic Council chairmanship that begins in just 2 months. The theme of our chairmanship is One Arctic with shared opportunities, challenges, and responsibilities. But what specifically are we going to choose to do with our chairmanship? Well, we have three key stated goals: stewardship of the Arctic Ocean, advancing the health and welfare of people who live in the Arctic area, and mitigating the effects of climate change. Let me just say a little bit about each of those. First, Arctic Ocean safety and stewardship. There is an increased number of people now going to the Arctic. This year, we will see 200,000 tourists going up to the Arctic on cruise ships. That is a situation that begs for training and planning, given the fact that there is rather minimal search and rescue infrastructure in place in the Arctic. So we have a search and rescue agreement between the Arctic Council states. It's in place. Now's the time to, and now's the opportunity to exercise it to identify best practices. Energy exploration. If there is an oil spill in the Arctic, are we ready for it? How would we clean up an oil spill in the Arctic? Any human endeavor in the Arctic is 10 times as hard as anywhere else on Earth. Take a look at the cover story of the New York Times Magazine just last month of the Kulik, that Shell had an oil rig called the Kulik had placed in the Chukchi Sea up in the Arctic. That is a metaphor to even how the most technically competent companies can be ill-prepared for operations in the Arctic. We now have a decrease in oil prices. That means that Arctic oil exploration is on hold for now. Different energy people will tell you that Arctic oil exploration makes sense at different numbers. I've heard recently from a top-level oil executive $150. I don't know if that's accurate or not, but where oil is right now, which is about two times lower than that, it doesn't make sense. And given that, we have a little bit of breathing space to work on increasing infrastructure and advancing best practices when it comes to oil exploration in the Arctic. Second goal, improving the welfare and health for the peoples who live in the Arctic areas. The US wants to improve freshwater accessibility, telecom, and renewable energy technology in the Arctic. Take renewable energy. Millions of Arctic residents rely on dirty and inefficient diesel-generated heat and electricity. If we don't act to replace that, the long-term effects of black carbon on human health will make these communities harder to inhabit. In the area of telecom, the Arctic lacks adequate telecom infrastructure, a situation that is untenable given the growing human activity in the Arctic. And so our Arctic Council chairmanship will explore options to build out the telecom infrastructure in the future. There will be a focus on physical and mental health. Suicide rates in the Arctic are among the highest in the world. Creating a common set of metrics and indicators for suicide risk and prevention and response is absolutely the right thing to do. The third goal of the US chairmanship, addressing the impact of climate change. Climate change is having a massive impact on biodiversity, and there are things happening in the Arctic that you can't even see with your own eyes. Take ocean acidification. The more carbon absorbed by the ocean, the more acidic it is. And what does acidification do, say, to the shells of shellfish? There's an increasing number of invasive plant species in the Arctic. Local Inuits in Alaska will tell you that polar bears are starting to breed with brown bears. Is that an adaptive behavior when species are at risk? We want to improve our understanding of what's happening in the Arctic. We want to expand monitoring of black carbon and methane emissions. We're going to work with a broad range of stakeholders, including Arctic Council observer nations and industry, to advance measures to prevent emissions. And the US chair will take a global approach in raising public awareness in the US and abroad about the Arctic and why it is such a precious resource that should be important to us all. So we have difficult choices as a nation going forward as we begin our Arctic Council chairmanship, and a lot of what happens will depend on US leadership. The bottom line is that the US is the second largest global emitter of CO2 after China, and we're the number one per capita emitter of CO2. So US leadership is essential in not only getting other countries to cooperate, but it's essential to actually inhibiting climate change. It's important to emphasize that we're not opposed to economic development in the Arctic, but we need to pursue development in a sustainable manner that takes into account the impact on Arctic inhabitants and on the environment. So let me close by saying that when I was a student sitting in those very seats, I never could have imagined standing before you as an ambassador, as the personal representative of a historic president deployed in a country where my passion matches one of the core issues of our engagement. And part of me is still in those seats. A kid who came to Dartmouth from Virginia, I brought deer horns and hung them on the wall, and I wanted to do something about the environment, and Dartmouth gave me everything to pursue a journey in public service and to fight for something I am passionate about. And so that's what I challenge you to do. People can make a difference. When I was a kid, the Hudson River was dead. With the passage of the Clean Water Act of 1973, the Hudson is today now a relatively flourishing ecosystem. But when it comes to the Arctic, time is not on our side. I don't know the exact time, but my guess is that we have about 20 years to really do something about it. And after that, it may be too late. So let me close with a quote from another historic president, President John F. Kennedy, who made a very prescient observation that in fact nature can be a great unifier. And that's good, because when it comes to the challenge we face in the Arctic and climate change, we will need to have a unified global approach. And as President Kennedy put it, where nature makes natural allies of us all, we can demonstrate that beneficial relations are possible even with those with whom we most deeply disagree. And this must be someday the basis of world peace and world law. Thank you for listening.
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you, Ross.
That's good.
Absolutely. Thank you.
Mark, that was fantastic, and thank you. I've had the real pleasure of being at the embassy in Sweden and at residency a couple of times now with Mark and with Natalia, and you've treated us so well, and you've been so kind and so generous to Dartmouth, and it's nice to have you here. Think of this as our living room.
And, definitely.
What we want to do now is have a conversation, take some questions, and explore some of the points that you made.
Absolutely.
But let me reflect on this. I saw the title of your presentation coming through, and you used the words modern diplomacy. And I was thinking, well, what does that really mean? And if I was a Dartmouth student for 5 points, I had to write an answer. What is modern diplomacy? I'm not quite sure what I'd have asked, how I would have answered that. But after seeing your presentation, you are that person. You're the epitome of what that means.
Thank you.
And what I take from that is someone who sees a grand challenge and a really large, important, significant problem, and you've taken on climate change in the Arctic in that manner. Someone who understands that science is important to deal with that problem and that issue. And too often today, we hear the first thing anyone says in response of our political leaders to a question, I'm not a scientist.
Right.
But that's not an excuse. Yep. It's not an excuse for not understanding science is important. And you've taken the time to learn the science, to work with scientists, and as you've shown here, to communicate the science. And that's, I think, quite remarkable. And I think at the face of it, that's really what modern diplomacy is going to be about. And I think you're going to be changing the way that other diplomats begin to think about the profession, their obligations, and the ways that they're expected to contribute to solving global problems, which is just what the Dickey Center is about, what the Institute of Arctic Studies wants to do, and what the Montgomery Fellows Program is about, is bringing leaders in. So I just wanted to say that,
thank you
for that. So we've seen a lot about the Arctic, about climate and science, and some of the social and political issues that are there. And I do have to say that Mark really has found a way to elevate Arctic within the State Department. This Fulbright program really, I just can't imagine that it would be in place without your persistence and your knowledge and your connections and just working that and showing people that it's important. And so I know that my co-lead scholar, Mike Sfraga from Alaska, will both be turning to you for advice, as we have already, as we move forward with this program. So, but we've talked about Arctic and climate, but that's really just part of your portfolio there. I mean, you're running an embassy, you're representing so many other issues that connect to the Arctic, that relate to grand challenges. They're geopolitical, they're environmental, they're climate change on a global basis, not just the Arctic. So I wonder if you could talk maybe a little bit about the other things that excite you or keep you up at night. I mean, what are the other dimensions of being an ambassador that you might want to share with us? And then from there, we'll open it up to questions from the audience.
Well, thank you, Ross, for what you said, first of all. I'm honored to hear that, especially from you. Second, modern diplomacy is about new tools and new partnerships, but it's also about truly being present in a country where you're deployed, which means not just being at an embassy or behind embassy walls, but really embracing the society where you've been lucky enough to be deployed. And that is exactly what I and my wife have tried to do at US Embassy Stockholm. I've done a number of different things to try to be present in Sweden. First of all, I think we have really tried to bring literally thousands of Swedes and people from elsewhere into the embassy to reflect the fact that America is a country that embraces diversity. That's an important challenge for us all. And we've tried to do different things that are creative at US Embassy Stockholm. We've, for example, created a series called Diversity Dialogues, where we seize upon different visitors coming to Sweden and say, sit down with this group of Swedes and people from elsewhere, Americans and others, around this table, and let's talk about diversity. So what are examples of that? When the governor of Minnesota was coming to Sweden, Minnesota is the land of Swedish Americans, when Governor Mark Dayton was coming to Sweden, he came on a trade and commercial visit. But I asked Governor Dayton to sit down with the Somali Swedish community. Why? Because Minnesota has more Somali Americans per capita than any other state in the United States. And Sweden has a big influx of asylees from Somalia. And integration has been a challenge in both America and Sweden. And I wanted the chief executive of Minnesota, who has a self-interest in things going well, to sit down with Somali Swedes and to share what works and what didn't in the case of Minnesota. So that's one way that we have tried to use the platform of an embassy. We had Muhammad Yunus, Nobel Prize winner, sit down and talk about entrepreneurship and business and multiculturalism and diversity. So we've really tried to join the Swedes in understanding and advancing the embrace of diversity, which is such a shared value. Another thing that I did, Ross, this past summer was I bicycled across Sweden from literally the water's edge on the west coast to the water's edge of the east coast. And I'm not a cycler. I didn't know that I could do it when I started out, quite frankly. But I knew that once I started, if I had to crawl to the finish line, I was going to do it, because I couldn't not do it once I started. But it was 600 plus miles across Sweden, across the heartland of Sweden, to little towns that you may not have heard of, like Alingsås and Falköping and Kumla and Carlsberg and Hovde. But across Sweden, I did meetings with, say, groups of women farmers who seek to sell their products abroad, or gaming codifiers at the University of Hovde. You may not have heard of the University of Hovde, but they are among the best gaming coders in the world. And remember, Sweden is the land of Minecraft and Mojang. And met with chambers of commerce to talk about trade and so forth. Other than walking across Sweden, there is no other way I could have embraced Sweden more than by bicycling across it.
Well, I've followed you across Sweden on Facebook and social media, and I have to say it's probably more of a challenge for your staff. I imagine they were a little surprised that they were going to pedal across Sweden with you.
Very true.
But that's part of that creativity, I think, that when you talk about modern diplomacy.
Yeah.
Well, let's open it up. Let's start a conversation here, and I'd always love to take a question from a student first, if we can do that. I mean, I have plenty of students that I know in the audience, so put them on the spot, but let's go for it. And we have a microphone that you'll need to speak into, because we're recording this so that we can use this in the future.
Terrific.
Hello?
Yeah.
Great, it's working. So I'm Trevi, I'm a 14. You spoke very eloquently regarding the direct linkage between what is happening in the Arctic right now and what is or will be occurring in our backyards. The difficulty, however, seems to be effectively communicating that connection back home. I'd be grateful to hear you elaborate more on this challenge and what reception you have found speaking to people around the US. Thank you.
That's a great question, because I think communication is at the heart of actually mobilizing resources to address this threat. In democracies, people won't support the deployment of leadership and resources if they don't know about it, and proliferating greater understanding of what is happening in the Arctic and climate change is a central challenge right now, and I'm not sure it has yet been done fully effectively, because too few people know about it. And so that's why we've tried to use social media and to really engage with people who have their own platforms through either culture or the arts or through kind of, political leadership and so forth, to get the attention and to get the focus on this critical challenge. But what you ask there is the central question. How do you effectively, on a mass level, in near time, communicate the challenge of the Arctic? And that's something that I think we're all still learning, although it's a major priority and goal of the Obama administration as we go into our Arctic Council chairmanship. And I will say that I've been really impressed by, for example, I just saw a YouTube by President Obama on his announcement designated 12 million acres in the Arctic area as a national refuge, and making the case for why it's important. Because I think it crystallizes in just a couple of minutes the essence of what we face losing and what we stand to gain by actually turning that into a refuge. And I think that's kind of what it's going to take, because this is complex. It goes to the heart of our economies. It's global. That's a hard thing to communicate, and getting that right is going to be an essential part of this.
Yeah, and I would encourage people, go to the embassy page that Mark and Natalia really run. I mean, you can see their personalities on their webpage, and see how the messaging really works. And it's important. It's there all the time. It's every day. It's wide ranging and it's connecting. But I think that's an important part of the message. I know the Fulbright program that he mentioned. One of the things that we're going to be dealing with very much is how to engage the scientific community into more effective communication about the problems, what we're doing, and the State Department is devoting resources to allow us to do that better.
Yeah.
So that's exciting.
Well, I think there's great organizations like the World Wildlife Fund and National Geographic and others who are both have platforms and are developing new platforms to communicate, a lot like Discovery does. And so a lot of people see that as an opportunity in the area of mass communication, actually. So I think going into it is actually an opportunity. It's not just a service.
Thanks, Charlie. There's a question over here.
Hi there. My name is Tim Rizvanov. I'm a 17. And you mentioned the geopolitics of the Arctic, and specifically the five Nordic countries, the United States, Canada, and Russia. I was wondering if you could inform me how the precedent that was set by the Antarctic, with the signing of the Antarctic Treaty, and the ways in which that could change in the future, given that the Arctic is much closer to the nations which were formerly at odds during the Cold War, and that there is such a much more clear economic advantage in terms of oil and natural gas, how that can affect the future of the Arctic as opposed to the Antarctic, and what's the relationship between the two?
Right. Well, you know, the Arctic during the Cold War was actually a place that was conflict-free, despite the fact that the Arctic is bordered by countries that during the Cold War were in geopolitical competition and conflict. And so I think that's an important legacy that we need to continue, that keeping the Arctic demilitarized, keeping the Arctic conflict-free, and making sure that any kind of race for resources doesn't emerge, but in fact, it's a place for constructive international cooperation is an important challenge and an opportunity, and it's absolutely a tippy-top priority for the Obama administration. So that's a really important starting point. And as you know, I mentioned Russia. We currently have major differences with Russia, given Ukraine, but we're continuing to work with Russia on the Arctic Council. And that makes sense, given the frontier that they have, our interests and our goals during our chairmanship. Working with them makes eminent sense in that regard. On the Antarctic piece, I know Ross has spent a lot of time there, and so perhaps I'll defer to you on that particular aspect of it.
Well, there's an international treaty that's been in effect since 1959 that preserves Antarctica for peaceful purposes, and there's that treaty is held. It's often promoted as, you know, the one truly effective international treaty that's in place. But at the same time, the immediate economic opportunities, the resources, all these things that drive conflict and international interests are not really present in Antarctica at the current time. So in some ways, it's pretty easy to set Antarctica aside and agree on certain core principles about its future. The Arctic is so much more complicated because we have people, we have economies, we have resources that are readily extractable. We have indigenous peoples. We don't have people living in Antarctica except in and out scientists like myself. But nonetheless, there's a lot of people that propose that maybe we really do need an Arctic treaty based on the Antarctic treaty. There's a group of people that propose this and are working very hard at that. I think it's a long uphill struggle. It may not be a feasible solution, but I think the very fact that people look at the Arctic as a place where we need such agreement is important. And I think Ambassador Brzezinski and the Obama administration, through the U.S. chairmanship program, are really looking at the international dimensions of the Arctic and what role does the U.S. have on the international future of the Arctic, not just what's important for Alaska.
Yeah, and remember, the very first agreement of the Arctic Council was the search and rescue. That was, you know, that came together very recently during the Swedish chairmanship, and then oil spill preparedness and cleanup. And so while we have this drop in oil prices, and while we have the opportunity to exercise and test and train on these agreements, I think that in itself will collaterally result in working together between these different countries around the Arctic in different ways. So my forecast would be that there would be more agreements pertaining to the Arctic area in some of these critical areas, whether it's in protecting biodiversity or search and rescue, which there's more and more realization that we have a totally untenable situation in the Arctic with now many thousands, hundreds of thousands of people going up there and with limited search and rescue capacity. And no one wants another Gulf of Mexico disaster that occurred with the BP rig occurring in the Arctic. And there's a greater understanding on industry, infrastructure companies, resource companies that, thanks to social media and the way people communicate today, that turning the Arctic into a dumping ground for Western production or something like that is not going to work. You do not want to become the poster child of bad behavior in the Arctic. And there's more and more ways to forensically investigate who did what, when, where, and how in remote places now than ever before.
Gonna make you work, Chris.
Thank you.
Hello, it's a small world, Mr. Brzezinski. Lori Sestowski, former colleague of Hogan and Hartson.
Oh my gosh, yes.
20 years, I think.
Lori, she was a partner when I was an associate at Hogan and Hartson. Nice to see you, Lori.
Good to see you.
Blast too. From the past.
Yes, it is. With respect to oil and gas companies, is there a monolithic approach that companies are taking and about development? And also, what kind of approach are they taking in terms of dialogue or lobbying with the various countries in the Arctic?
Well, I don't know, Lori, if you saw the New York Times piece on the Kulik just last month, but that in itself was a big-time wake-up call for those who focus on energy extraction in the Arctic, because the thought was that everything that should be done was done, and then that major problem occurred, and the new special representative for the Arctic, Admiral Robert Papp, used to be commandant of the Coast Guard, and he was deploying young men and women to that oil rig to rescue oil rig workers, and no one wants to see that happen again. So a lot of this is we are learning, and thankfully with not yet a drilling disaster in the Arctic, what are some of the very real limits of doing something like this in the Arctic? But no, I don't think that there is a kind of monolithic understanding of what it is to be done, but I do think that there's recognition that it should be done well, it should be extremely well understood what we're going into before we start drilling. And I think that's an important message that people are trying to share around the world, because people can have kind of like a gold rush mentality when it comes to the Arctic, and that is an incredibly tough context in which to work. And I think the more lessons learned and best practices that are shared and proliferated and trained and exercised together, the better off we are. I think that that's increasingly a common understanding. And I very much feel that the bringing on of the observers that have been brought on, China, India, Korea, Singapore. Singapore has a division within its Ministry of Foreign Affairs focused on the Arctic. Singapore is a big shipping country. It has brought into the conversation those who were less part of the conversation before. And I think that's a good opportunity that the observership process has produced.
Thomas, and then way in the back after that.
So the language of business and opportunity that seems to be reoccurring throughout your presentation, I was wondering if you're willing to speak about the role of capitalism in climate change?
The role of?
The role of capitalism in climate change, as Naomi Klein has recently pointed out.
It's interesting, that's a great question, because I was honored to have dinner with the president of Dartmouth, Phil Hanlon, last night, and we talked about what works in terms of inspiring people to do something and to put on the table the choices and maybe even the sacrifices that people will have to make to do something about this. And he very eloquently made the case about emphasizing and amplifying the real opportunity associated with sustainability and innovation, that the reward for innovation pertaining to sustainability has yet to kind of fully catch the wave that, say, innovation as it pertains to IT or innovation as it pertains to traditional extractive industries has had. But if that could catch that wave, it would drive so much more positive R&D in this area. And I think that that's an incredibly good thought, because I think innovation should be viewed through the prism, not only in terms of kind of existing industries, but might there be a way to channel innovation to future challenges and future opportunity to really gear up innovation in that area, in the area, for example, of sustainability. And that's what I see increasingly in Sweden, where there's given the commitment of the country to go carbon free. And remember, Sweden has made choices that America has not made. It has land use policies that America would never have. It's a democracy, very different than America's democracy. It's a democracy based on consensus. We have a kind of an adversarial system. We feel that that produces the best results. But they've made a national decision to go carbon free, so they have a carbon tax, for example. And generally, this has produced an approach to sustainability and a system of rewards and results that kind of, I think, goes to your question.
Way in the back, Chris.
I'm William. I'm a medical student here. So it's great to have you come here. So my mom was actually born in Malmö.
Oh, yeah, right.
It was great to hear all the good things about Sweden.
Yeah.
And also, so I was wondering, animal agriculture is one of the largest causes of greenhouse gas emissions, and especially that can affect the Arctic. So I was wondering what sorts of policies are either being thought about or are going to be planned to kind of decrease animal meat consumption and dairy consumption, and to try to promote a plant-based diet as a means to decrease carbon animal or methane gas emissions in the world.
Yeah. Well, that kind of goes to what the focus is of a group that we sponsored at the embassy that we tried to help build relations in Sweden for, with the Swedish private sector and the Swedish government, and that's the Rainforest Alliance. Putting that little green frog to indicate an effort towards sustainability has real results, business results. And I think that we're going to see increasingly a proliferation of what is, so to speak, the good housekeeping seal of approval in terms of food production and what isn't. I think that, you know, when you take a look at generational change, the younger generation is much more is very committed to walking the walk when it comes to sustainability. They want to see sustainability reflected in their place of work. They want to see sustainability reflected in the food that they eat. And so I think that will become increasingly an important label or brand that can advance good results when it comes to sustainability. I don't know, Ross, if you have further to add on that.
No, I think the connections between lifestyle and choice and diet and carbon and climate are real, and everyone, I think, is trying to sort those out. Interesting, one of the major challenges in the North is to think about subsistence foods and traditional foods that are disappearing and the health benefits to communities and being able to. We saw your colleague, the Sami reindeer herder, where that's the reindeer, that's food, but it's also the center of their culture and language. And so I think the key for the North is to provide diet choice, but also to provide opportunities for people that want to engage in traditions and culture and find deep meaning in the way that they relate to animals to make sure that that's part of the future. Because if, just as he expressed, once we lose that, it can't come back, and it's a loss to the whole globe.
Definitely. No, I think that Nila Inga's engagement is incredibly prescient. And when he talks about the end of the reindeer herding society in the video, you'll see he's talking about a 20-year time frame. Because the reindeer, because the way the snow is changing, the reindeer cannot smell pasture through the snow because there's more ice layers. Ticks have never been seen on reindeer in the Arctic area of Sweden. Now ticks are on reindeer, and ticks carry viruses, not just for reindeer. So there's all kinds of implications that pertain to what he invokes as the possible end of his society completely, that also pertain to major impacts on the way our society exists as well.
That's a great question. Thank you.
Yeah, definitely.
Sure, just grab one, please. Over here. Oh. Didn't see you, Tom.
Ambassador Brzezinski, thank you so much for your comments.
It's
really interesting to hear your perspective. Many of us in this audience are graduate students and doing research in the sciences, and we're interested in these issues that you've brought up and doing research on them, and also have firsthand experiences in these environments. And I'm wondering from your perspective, well, first off, I'm wondering when you interface with scientists to, if you want to get the latest scientists, where do you go? How do you do that?
yes, no, of course, lost, but other scientists as well. Yeah.
Right, and so right, what does that process look like for you? And then secondly, I'm wondering from your perspective, what do you think the role of scientists and the scientific community is if we want to make an impact and we want to be a part of this, but recognizing that it's much more complex than any single one of our fields, and just how scientists can be engaged thinking about a career.
Great question. Well, the way I have tried to interrelate with scientists is by sharing their knowledge well beyond me. So I've really focused on hosting at the U.S. Embassy scientists, whether from the National Geographic or from the Rainforest Alliance or from Dartmouth or from the Nobel Prize winners, to kind of share what they are seeing and what they're hearing. Because I think that there is too much of a disconnect sometimes between the policy community and the scientific community. And we don't have the time for that, given the threats that we face today. On the flip side, it is essential for the scientific community to be able to crystallize and catalyze for people what it is we're facing. Because I think that if people do not know or do not understand and do not have this effectively explained, the utility of the science is only a small percentage of it really is used, I feel, when it comes to advancing decision questions pertaining our engagement with the rest of the world. And so I've challenged the scientists who we have hosted at the embassy, speaking about climate change, speaking about the Arctic, to speak to people and communicate what you have in a way that someone can take a decision question home with them so that they can engage on that decision question on their own. And that communication piece is something that I've tried to advance through the Fulbright program and in other ways.
That's great. Thanks.
Hi, my name is Eric Bruner. I'm an 18 here at Dartmouth. My question to you is, working as a U.S. ambassador, you're obviously working in the U.S. government. How is it working alongside, or how do you feel about working, I guess, in the same government as the Senate, where the Senate's Environmental Committee, the chair of the Senate's Environmental Committee, is still a denier of human-caused climate change? I mean, just on January 22nd, The Guardian quoted James Inhofe, I believe, as saying, man cannot cause climate change. How does that feel?
Well, I will only say that, you know, we live in a democracy, and there was a very interesting article last week in the New York Times about the significant number of Democrats and Republicans are interested in supporting leaders who A, believe in climate change, and B, want to do something about it. They were looking at the 2016 presidential contest, but a significant proportion of Republicans and Democrats support that. So that's one thing, and it's pertinent to our democracy. Two, as US ambassador, I have loved receiving delegations, not just of Democrats, but of Republicans. My wife and I hosted the largest group of US senators to visit Sweden in the modern era, and they just happened to be all Republicans, led by Swedish-American Johnny Isaacson from the state of Georgia. And I really salute Senator Isaacson and the other senators, Mike Enzi, Lamar Alexander, Dan Coats, a congressman, among others on that delegation, who undertook a request I made to them, which was I hosted a dinner for the visiting Senate delegation with more than 75 of our Swedish friends from the Swedish Parliament, Swedish opinion makers, and others. And the question presented to the US senators that they engaged the audience was, what is distinctive about American conservatism and European conservatism? And it was one of the most interesting events that I've hosted at the embassy, because while there are great differences, there's actually a lot of synchronicity when it comes to where the planet is going. And have we somehow altered the chemistry of our planet, I feel. So I will say that I really appreciated their engagement in Sweden, regardless of Democrat or Republican, but that just happened to be a completely Republican delegation. And so we've seized every opportunity to work with people, because in the end, people with principle can disagree. That's just a fact of life. The question is, where can we identify a shared understanding of the threats that we face and a common path forward? And I actually think that in America, there's a lot more of an opportunity to advance that than we may see right now.
Hello, Ambassador. I'm Jerry Wang. I'm 18 here. So it seems that Sweden and many other European states have made much greater progress in terms of climate change and protecting the Arctic, or at least are more conscious of those things than the US is. Why do you think that is, and what do you think should be done to make us more on par with our European counterparts?
Okay. Well, that's a great question, and I think it's important to remember that our democracies are very different. America's democracy is a rather young democracy. We were founded by people often forced to leave from abroad and come to America to start a new life. We argue, we debate, sometimes loudly, in the course of our democracy, and that's how we get results. In the case of Sweden, it's a country with a democratic tradition that is thousands of years old, and it is much geared towards the process of consensus, meaning that there's recognition that there will be people who are on the right and the people who are on the left, but in the consensus process, there's an emphasis on coming together and figuring out where can we work together, and once that's identified, let's take action. It's very different from our democracy. So that's an important starting point when it comes to engagement on climate change and the environment and so forth. But I would also add to that there is a there's the Swedish word lagom that I mentioned earlier in my talk, which means balance, which often is invoked when it comes to people talking about work-life balance. But in Sweden, lagom, or balance, pertains to waste. It pertains to how food is made and used. It pertains to the balance between humankind and environment. And it's a big emphasis and focus of the culture. And it permeates so many decisions across the way money is spent, infrastructure is built, and so forth. And so I would say that is the essence of the answer to your question when it comes to Sweden. But it's important to remember that our democracies are very different.
Question here, Bruce.
Thank you very much. I'm Bruce Adutu. I'm a chair of Native American Studies here at Dartmouth,
okay.
Class
Great.
Of 80.
Fantastic.
So welcoming back to Dartmouth.
Thank you.
I want to go back to the question here and dig a little deeper, because you mentioned twice in your talk that one of the things we don't have much of right now is time.
Yeah.
And so the U.S. chairmanship of the Arctic Council for 2 years will coincide with Senate domination by the Republican side, including a chairman who denies that climate change has a human origin. So how do you think there's a risk that our chairmanship of Arctic Council will be scuttled by that political reality?
It's a great question, but I think that challenge is something that could be an opportunity that if we can really cast the threat in terms of the future of the Arctic and the threat of climate change as something that pertains to the future of our grandchildren, I think that people have a self-interest in addressing that. And that may bring people to the table, Democrats and Republicans, like other things can't. So that's my hope, that the greater understanding of this threat and what it means, not just to the Arctic or the people of the Arctic, but what it means to you and me in this room right now, will bring people to the table. But I do think that we have an ambitious set of goals pertaining to our chairmanship when it comes to delivering for the people in the Arctic area in terms of their health and welfare, in terms of business and industry, in terms of working with industry to mitigate the impact of climate change, in terms of taking an approach that recognizes that the human footprint in the Arctic will grow. But what can we do to make that human footprint safer and sounder? Can bring people together across the aisles? Because those things reflect both Democratic priorities and Republican priorities. There is definitely room to work together in those areas that are totally genuine to the core ideologies of both sides. And it will take leadership, and that's the challenge for the Obama administration, which I know that the president and the special rep take on very much, to kind of see what is the opportunity to bring people together around a shared future of the Arctic. And whether it's business or human safety, there's a lot of room to maneuver there. I really do believe that. And remember, it's not just Democrats and Republicans in the Arctic. It's the people of Alaska as well. It's the citizens of Alaska. It's the native peoples of Alaska. You know, there's, 3,800 miles from Washington, D.C. to Barrow, Alaska. We need to reduce that distance figuratively when it comes to a conversation and a dialogue in terms of how we're going to be engaging on our chairmanship in the future of the Arctic.
I am Jimmy Bolt. I'm a 15 here. And I wanted to ask if you think that human development in the Arctic, whether that be increased nautical commerce, oil, natural gas extraction, tourism, or increased infrastructure, if you think those things are accelerating or have the potential to accelerate the dramatic changes that we're seeing in the Arctic right now.
Well, they certainly have the chance to accelerate the changes. The question is, can we mitigate or do adaptation to lessen that chance? And part of that has to be a very honest conversation with all stakeholders, scientists and biologists, but also industry. And I have found in my industry conferences and roundtables that there is a willing ear from industry and business to engage in that conversation. No one wants to become the poster child for bad behavior in the Arctic. People see what happens, what happened in the Gulf of Mexico, and they don't want to be that. And so there's an opportunity to bring to the table industry and business and to develop a set of best practices and compliance programs so that everyone is on the same page. And the time to do that when it comes to extraction is now, when the oil price is down, because the drilling isn't occurring now as a result of a low oil price. So now is the time to really advance best practices. That's an opportunity that I think we'll try to seize during the U.S. chairmanship of the Arctic Council.
Yeah, I could add an important part of the Arctic Council is the role of the Indigenous Peoples Organizations, because the Arctic Council operates on a consensus basis. And so I think the U.S. chairmanship program is very much based on trying to understand what do the people of the North want and what are their aspirations and needs. And of course, there are many other stakeholders that are also in this discussion. But I think as an organization, the Arctic Council is unique because there's true power given to the Indigenous Peoples Organizations. And I always find that is a very, you talk about moving towards the center. Right. It's an important opportunity to broaden the discussion, to get different viewpoints. And I've always found that helps. And, yeah. But I think many people, I share some of the concerns that you've spoken about, this race for resources. You hear all these issues around mining oil and gas and the rate that we're going to be doing this. If there's anything that's beneficial about the energy turn down right now, is it's perhaps buying more time
right. For
us to really get our act together and decide how we can deal with a more sustainable path. But I think the U.S.'s program, the U.S. chairmanship program, is actually pretty good at dealing with these issues
right. From
what I've seen.
Yeah. And there's a specific focus and a priority given to gleaning indigenous knowledge from the permanent participants of the Arctic Council and others. In other words, native knowledge. And it's certainly my experience with the Sami people in northern Sweden, with whom I've spent significant time, that there is an awful lot to be learned by engaging with the indigenous people. They know the area best. They've heard. It's like being in a place your entire life, you know it intrinsically. And to glean that knowledge, we'd be well off to do that.
Okay. Well, we've reached 6 o'clock, and that really is the time that we had allotted. I do want to thank Chris again and Montgomery for this whole visit and this opportunity. Ambassador Brzezinski, thank you so much,
boss.
Natalia. And if you have other questions, why don't you just come down front? I think we have a few more minutes. And I just want to applaud you for staying and being very engaged.
Thank you. Great questions.
So thanks, all.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, boss.
Thank you. Well done.